Simon & Schuster Audio presents Glossy, Ambition, Beauty, and the Inside Story of Emily Weiss's Glossier by Marisa Meltzer. Read by Cassandra Medcalf. The Crosby. Emily Weiss was crying. The two of us were sitting in the middle of the restaurant at the Crosby Street Hotel in Lower Manhattan. Normally, when speaking to a reporter, Weiss would be chaperoned by a coterie of publicists. But this wasn't a fawning magazine piece about her billion-dollar makeup company, Glossier, or its over-the-top stores that have been described as a beauty Disney World. This was about a book. More specifically, the book you're reading now. Glossier changed everything after it debuted in 2014, from where and how products are sold to the kinds of emotional and social messages promoted, the intangible products, alongside skincare and makeup. Glossier is not just a beauty brand, but the millennial and Gen Z brand, one that launched on Instagram before it even had its first products. Working there had the same cachet as working at the country's most powerful tech companies. One former employee said of being recruited by Glossier in 2019, "I mean, this doesn't come along a lot. It's like a typical Mark Zuckerberg and Sheryl Sandberg case. If someone asks you to go sit on a rocket ship, you don't ask which chair." Weiss is one of the most visionary and consequential business leaders of her generation. She also got an ignominious start in the public eye, cast on the MTV reality show The Hills while she was an intern at Teen Vogue. America circa 2007 was in the grips of a reality TV boom. Weiss was tall, white, and beautiful, and had a fashion pedigree. After "Hi," her first words on screen were, "We have a big day ahead of us planning." She could correctly pronounce chinoiserie and identify cottage roses. They called her the super intern. Weiss does not like to discuss The Hills. "Oh my God, please don't talk about that. I went for like 2 days and it turned into 3 episodes. It was the first time I had even been to LA," she told me when I profiled her for Vanity Fair in 2019. I, too, would cringe at being associated with a TV show best known for black mascara tears and someone called Justin Bobby, but it was a very public glimpse of Weiss as a power player in the making. From her reality TV arc, she founded the beauty blog Into the Gloss in 2010. Its candid reviews and intimate interviews with a mix of celebrities and models and media types felt like being invited to a really cool cocktail party, or just gathering in the bathroom and trying on a friend's products. It was a hit. By early 2012, the site had more than 200,000 unique visitors per month, and by May 2016, that number had swelled to 1.3 million. Weiss didn't just want to be a new media titan. She wanted to make products. In her quest to raise money, she was initially passed over by about a dozen venture capitalists until she met with one woman who saw her potential. Less than 5 years after its launch, Glossier had a $1 billion valuation. The proverbial unicorn. Weiss didn't build Glossier to be acquired by a beauty monolith like Estée Lauder. She wanted to become Estée Lauder. "I want to be the beauty version of Nike," Weiss said. "I plan to, you know, like, just do it." If the beauty industry has an it girl, one who radiates genuine self-made power as well as genuine mystique, it's probably Weiss. And it's all enough to make the company's success seem effortless. As of July 2021, Glossier was valued at $1.8 billion. But like the labor of applying makeup to make you look naturally beautiful, nothing about Glossier is effortless. Even though Weiss has been compared to household names like LeBron James, Barbara Walters, Mary Kay Ash, and Steve Jobs, she was a recessive CEO. "No one I've interviewed, and I've been in the room with a lot of famous people, has generated more curiosity about what they're really like than Emily Weiss. She has viewed her privacy as a kind of political stance. If you're reading stories about male founders, it's very rare to have as much intrigue around what they're wearing. Although, I occupy sort of a weird middle place between tech and beauty, and women are so hungry to have more role models and know more about women who have achieved what they want in their careers. But for me, who's such a mirror for others, it's a funny thing. Because I'm so used to being a person who's curious, she said to me. We were standing in her apartment, the only time she's ever let a journalist into her home. She said something to the effect that she couldn't exactly let in every writer who wanted to see where she lived. From the windows of Weiss's living room, you can see the Glossier office, I wrote. That doesn't bode well for work-life balance, but she swears the proximity allows her to sleep in, she's not a morning person, and walk to work. It's a rental apartment, heavy on natural light, with the same white, pink, and red palette as one of her thronged pop-ups. In the bedroom, laundry is air-drying on a rack in the corner. I was immediately intrigued by the collection of books she had in her living room. She had copies of Bad Blood about Theranos founder Elizabeth Holmes and Principles by Ray Dalio, the founder of Bridgewater, two separate hardcovers of Angela Duckworth's Grit, Small Fry, the memoir by Steve Jobs' daughter, Lisa Brennan Jobs, The Everything Store, about Amazon, Powerhouse, on the Hollywood talent agency CAA, Sophia Amoruso's Nasty Galaxy. Other titles were Strengths Finder 2.0, The Innovator's Dilemma, Mindset, Originals, Imagine It Forward, Sense Making, A Mind of Your Own, The Secret Language of Relationships. At least, that was what was in the white section, as her stacks of books were organized by color. I wondered if she had read every business book in existence. I wanted to note more, but when she came out of the bedroom, she caught me photographing them instead of writing all the titles down before I could get to the other colors. "Do you like my hodgepodge?" she asked. "You're looking at my hodgepodge of books, trying to discern what they say about me." Her confidence was striking. She seemed to always know what to say. Weiss was clearly aware of the power of the CEO origin story. Jeff Bezos had his door desks. Steve Jobs had his garage. Jobs' biographer, Walter Isaacson, wrote, "So was Mr. Jobs smart? Not conventionally. Instead, he was a genius." That may seem like a silly word game, but in fact, his success dramatizes an interesting distinction between intelligence and genius. His imaginative leaps were instinctive, unexpected, and at times, magical. They were sparked by intuition, not analytic rigor. He didn't study data or crunch numbers, but like a pathfinder, he could sniff the winds and sense what lay ahead. At that point in her career, Weiss was figuring out her legacy and how she wanted her own story to be told. When I left her home that afternoon in the summer of 2019, I walked directly to a bookstore in search of well-known startup stories about female-led companies. There had to be something out there, but I came up short. Weiss was a player who understood the game when it came to image and the CEO, so she must have encountered the same lack of stories about women that I did. There were scant biographies about founders of beauty companies born in the early 20th century, like Estée Lauder, and a handful of books that were more about self-help, like Sandberg's Lean In. But the gender disparity was startling. There was almost nothing about women CEOs in tech, let alone those like Weiss, whose career touched on myriad industries and facets of culture. There was no one like her. The gender imbalance was also wildly apparent in who writes books about figures in business. A sea of men. I knew that I could be the one to create a balanced view of Weiss and all that her company has innovated, without sugarcoating her flaws. I've been reporting on beauty for nearly two decades for the most respected publications in the world. I have written about Weiss for the past 10 years. I would describe our relationship as warmly professional. In early February of 2020, we had a brief text exchange about how she should write a business book of her own and I should ghostwrite it. She told me I first needed to read Brotopia, but nothing more progressed once the coronavirus pandemic descended upon us a few weeks later. Glossier's story, her story, was important to tell, and I was determined to write about it. I started working on a book idea a few months later. The Crosby was packed with people at noon on a Friday, rushing waiters carrying $30 chopped salads, the sounds of silverware clinking, and ambient conversations from the Manhattan demimonde. Low-hanging light fixtures in crayon colors of green and red matched upholstered banquettes. Portraits of hunting dogs lined the walls, and the floor-to-ceiling windows opened onto a terrace. The hotel was at the center of Weiss's world, just minutes away from her former apartment and Glossier's office. A lot had happened since the last time I had seen her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.